Alrighty, welcome back. Let's get right into things with our first speaker. She is the CCO and partner at Emedes. She is an independent consultant for platforms and marketplaces that are building for Web 3.0. She recently traveled to 50 countries to get a real feel for tech startups and communities, focused on community leadership, strategic partnerships, and consulting work for emerging industries, including future of work, blockchain, AI, and data ethics. Please welcome Rosanna Nasso.
Thank you for having me. I'll deduct 1 point for spelling my name incorrectly, but that's fine. So let's get started. My name is Roxana, and I'm the CCO and partner of Emedes. I'm a CSO at Taggin, and today I will be talking about privacy. And I think it's very important to discuss privacy because, especially in the current context, privacy matters more than we thought it would matter. With coronavirus, with governments that have started taking radical approaches to the way we think, we act, we interact with each other, the way we define social, the way we define borders, the way we define economy, and so on. So today we're seeing an increase in what we call draconian measures, with the government implementing emergency measures to survey us, basically leading to a global surveillance program. And privacy has been, it's like one of these evergreen topics that we discuss. I mean, you can never have too much privacy, you can never have less privacy. It's important that we continue the discussion. But what we saw in the recent situation with coronavirus is we saw liberties and freedoms that were basically trashed away for the purpose of, containing the virus, containing the situation. And whereas short term this matters, obviously, it's important that we stay at home, we limit our social interactions, we wear protective medical equipment when we go out. It is also important to understand that we can't be locked down forever. And at some point, we have to go out, we have to go back to what we believe was a normal life. And we saw that governments implemented tracking systems. Currently they're partnering with big tech to provide tracing opportunities and try to figure out where are areas of danger, where we should stay away from once we get what they call re-included into society. And what this is a good solution in tracing and understanding where potential danger could be. It's also counterproductive, so to speak, because the data that you collect from every individual, especially location data, which in most cases is related to where we spend most of our time, whether at home or at the office or in particular areas, location that is private, so to speak, that can be wrapped up under PII, which is personally identifiable information. The data is not protected. Most of the systems proposed right now, they function based on a flow of data. So that means that encryption, data protection, and privacy is put aside, and what matters is this flow of transparency. Whereas transparency matters for systems, privacy matters for the individual. And this again is very important because health data, location data of your most visited and, you know, most stationary places is personally identifiable information. It is sensitive information. It is information that should be protected and guarded, so to speak. And I'll give you an example. We saw more countries joining what was conducted by China, South Korea, Iran, Israel, and so on, into contact tracing and kind of this surveillance program that's being developed right now. Then we saw other countries joining in, like South Africa, for example, which is important because it's part of what we call banking the unbanked, right, in our blockchain directives. Well, South Africa, for example, collects the data and stores it in the server. The data is not anonymized. So that means you rely on the security of the server. You rely on the security of the means used in collecting the data. And in most cases, that security is very poor. It is weak. Because as we saw in the world, a lot of the times, cybersecurity is put last. We also saw with Zoom, for example, that data protection, security of the means of communication of the systems we use in applications is also put on a secondary side, and more importantly, focusing on collecting the data, because data is, well, data can be monetized. But in the current situation, data provides an aspect of our daily lives, also for governments and for hackers. These are two major points where I think it is important to have solutions that put security first and encryption first, and then transparency second. And this is the best scenario we can have to prove that cryptography is relevant, blockchain is relevant, Bitcoin works. You know, we've always wanted a different kind of use case for Bitcoin than for monetary system and transaction side. So, for example, if we're collecting the data, we could hash the data location and store it on the Bitcoin blockchain because it is secure, and it hasn't been capable of being hacked, for example. So that makes it a very strong advocate for storing this kind of data. Now, there's an issue with storing health data on a blockchain because health data is sensitive data, and with privacy laws, you might have issues. But when it comes to contact tracing, for example, which is a big deal of how to manage the current situation. So if you look at it, we have contact tracing, and then we have ongoing testing being done because we need fresh data, we need relevant data, not biased data that we get from hospitals, in order to develop the right solutions to research, to understand how the virus works, to understand how it develops in the human body, to create a vaccine, to create a treatment, and so on. So these two major components, okay? Data that we collect freshly through tests, and then contact tracing to understand where we can avoid certain areas where we should have stronger measures, precautionary measures. Now, the contact tracing data, as I said, can be used in different ways. This is where cryptography makes sense. So one would be hashing the location data and storing it on the Bitcoin blockchain. Another one would be, and we see already this working, would be Bluetooth contact tracing, providing an encrypted key, which then is stored in a database that is managed by a healthcare worker. And the moment you have matching, let's say matching addresses, matching locations, and we know that one of the users had been infected with COVID-19, then the worker can send a message, a warning sign on the phones of those that were a match. The problem here is we rely on the, let's say, the security of our devices. And on the manufacturer side, we have seen issues with Bluetooth. We have seen vulnerabilities like KNOB. And these vulnerabilities have not been addressed. Unless if your phone is, let's say, produced after 2018, then you're probably safe to use a Bluetooth contact tracing app. If your phone has been manufactured before that, and it's an older version, then you are kind of susceptible to all these vulnerabilities, all these opportunities to get hacked. Bluetooth contact tracing is one, but has many issues. As I said, manufacturer vulnerabilities, vulnerabilities from the device part. You also have to be around 15 minutes around the same area and have it have location enabled. So that means in that moment when you're using the app and you're outside, if you're in an area, let's say a big city, if you are a person of high rank, if you're a target for hackers, it would be quite easy to get hacked, so to speak. They can send a fake key to your device, and then they can infect your device basically in just a couple of steps. Another way to tackle contact tracing with cryptography would be, and this is one of the most interesting ideas that I've come across so far, would be not just to hash the data collect it through a public key, but also to look at the way it is stored on a server. And in this sense, you'd have not just the server that's being stored on, but you'd have a network of servers, kind of similar to Tor. So you'd have different servers that would, we call them mixnets, that would basically mix the information so that by the time it does arrive in the government servers, you cannot trace it back. You don't know where exactly it came from, but you still have the relevant information in it. So I think, I think it makes sense. It's a good opportunity for us in the crypto space. Please don't create tokens. Don't create weird blockchain projects where you just store medical sensitive data on a blockchain. It does not make sense. But use cryptography, use encryption, which is a subset, one of the most important subsets of cryptography. Use it, improving that it does make sense. Hash location data on the Bitcoin blockchain, or look into distributed databases, basically. Look at distributed databases where you can store the information, but they're not immutable. This means that in a couple of years, that information can be removed, or in a set time can be removed because it is private information. And I'm very excited with what blockchain and crypto has to offer, especially in this crisis. The way I address privacy is we have to talk about it. We have to deliver solutions. We have to have alternatives. Governments are not going to accept them for sure unless we strongly lobby, unless the consumer steps up, because the consumer has a lot of power. Okay, the consumer is one of the most powerful people when it comes to technology, because we, by using and lobbying and encouraging the use of privacy tools, we can change the way things are done. We can attract investors that will put more money into privacy technology. We can convince through petitions and key leaders, we can convince governments that this is the way to do it. Otherwise, we will end up being in a very dark place. where we have mass surveillance, you have a replica of communism, and you don't have the freedoms that you have today, at least. Thank you.
Roxanne, thank you very, very much for your talk. Absolutely wonderful talk and an awesome way to kick things off. Obviously, data privacy and security is an incredibly huge topic. I work in the world of data and artificial intelligence, so it's a massive topic, especially for a lot of our big main clients, including governments. They're having big problems. So before the mainstream adoption of maybe hashing information and using these distributed networks, maybe you would know some ideas, because it's a challenge that we're running into. So I would love to hear if you know anything in regards to anonymizing data. I don't think all companies are bad actors in trying to game the system or be irresponsible with data, but they're having a hard time with like anonymizing data so they can use it. And they're almost forced to use their data because they need to stay competitive. Is there anything on the market or something that you've researched recently that can help companies anonymize their data effectively so they can prep it to use it?
So the way to do it is, first you have to understand you can't have complete zero anonymization. Like, you can't reach ground zero when it comes to anonymizing data. The data we anonymize, it can be re-identified to some degree. But what you can do is you can use specific practices and frameworks. So one would be the key anonymity framework, which encourages not just to strip the personal identifiable information, but also to mix the data in a way that can ensure that it's becoming harder to re-identify it and rebuild the flow of data, so to speak, back to the identity of the person. It's a very complex project. You have to work with academics. You have to also work on the technology that you're using. So it's a mix of technology and academics to this point.
Super. Yes, thank you very much. We have time for one more question. It's actually a question from me. I'm very interested in your 50-country journey, visiting tech startups and the digital world. And I'm just wondering what was maybe your most fond moment of this journey that you went on and maybe the thing that you learned the most on that epic journey.
Wow, it's hard because every country has its, has its specifics. And I've worked online since 2009. So for me, it was very important to go and see how other startup ecosystems are working and get the feel right there. And I was also interested in how crypto was evolving in every market. But one of the best moments was actually in Bangkok, because I've been to Bangkok 3 times. The first time I didn't know anyone. It was quite weird. The second time I started knowing people. And the third time before I went, I created this online community, which is active even now, 2 years later. And we've managed to, do business and help each other and have some local support for expats living in Bangkok.
Super. Thank you so much, Roxanne. Before we go, where can people find you? Where can they touch base with you if they would like?
Well, I'm on Telegram and on LinkedIn and Twitter. So you just look for my first name and last name for the hat. And let's continue the conversation there.
Super. Fantastic. Thank you very much for kicking things off. And we'll see you next time.